it's really a pleasure to be here. It's also a real privilege for me to be here. It's the first time I've been to KAIST. It's a really great campus, a great place. You know, particularly, it's a privilege just because, and I looked at all these speakers, and you have all these pretty impressive speakers, and here I am just sort of starting my career as an academic, so it is really a nice opportunity to be here. I'm just going to outline my talk to you. I'm going to begin by introducing to you C. elegans, and I really want to convince you that C. elegans is an excellent system to study biology. And then I'm going to talk about two kind of ongoing projects in our lab that are sort of at the fringes of biology. This one here, and one having to do about gravity. So I wanted to show you this just because I spent a lot of time making this for a high school presentation last week with a bunch of high school students. But yes, I studied biology, and I'm not, you know, this session's supposed to be about medicine. I'm not a doctor. Oh, actually, I am a doctor, but I'm not that kind of cool doctor that you see in the show. I'm kind of a boring doctor. But I hope, you know, I can convince you that studying basic sciences and basic biology is important. It's really impactful for medicine. You know, this is kind of what we study in basic biology. Here we start billions of years ago as this. And here's a human zygote. Over some time, we evolved, and each one of us started just like this, as a human zygote. And over time, we get a lot of different changes, and eventually, something more impressive results. You get a lot of good changes. I know the girls have this a lot, so I put it here. and as basic biologists, we study this process that results from changes of over the lifetime of an organism. So I want to show you this small video, because I really like this. It's a fun video. You've probably seen it. You can find it on YouTube. It's simple. It's just a video of it. Modern medical technology as well. So the question that I want is, I want to know what genes and proteins are important for health and biology. And so how do we study that? How do we study that? We have our baby here, you know, and is this the way we, no. This is not the way we study. We don't study biology. We don't take cute little babies and cut them off. No. I want to give you a better model. We don't want to do that. But I'll give you something else that we study. And this is what I study in my lab, in my research. So some of you might be looking at this. What is that? Maybe it's a little bit scary. What this is C. elegans, and it's a nematode. And this nematode has been used a lot in science. It's led to a lot of major breakthroughs. Amazing when you think about it. This little picture here. And it's what we use to study. This is called C. elegans, C. noradaitis elegans. And we affectionately call it the worm. It's really small, although it looks very big. It's only 1 millimeter long. Very safe to use. It won't bite you, won't do anything, won't go in your body. Really easy to grow. It makes a lot of babies really fast. And the amazing thing is that even though this organism is so different from us, 40% of C. elegans genes are conserved in humans, meaning we essentially have a lot of the same genes in humans and in C. elegans. C. elegans starts from one cell, of course, and it results in 959 cells, exactly. Every C. elegans has 959 cells. And this is just a movie of that process going from one to almost 959. One cell, two cell, four cell, eight cell, throughout. The thing about this is lots of scientists study this process. And in this process, a lot of the major discoveries over the last 30 years or so in biology have occurred just by studying the development from 1 to 959 cells. And you may ask, but how could studying this result in some major breakthrough, some major finding, something that will, you know, possibly one day cure diseases? Well, let me tell you a little story. So, like I said, it goes from one cell to 959 cells exactly. We call that an invariant lineage cell development. It doesn't change. It has the same development throughout. And it doesn't ever change. So there was a guy back in the 1970s, his name is Sir John Sulston, over here, who decided, I'm going to look at every single cell in C. elegans and follow the development. From one cell to two cells to four cells to eight, six, and he every single cell, all 959 cells, right? As you saw, the development takes about, takes about 12 hours. He followed every cell on a microscope for several years, just did that. And what he did was he made a map that looked like this. Each one of these are different cells, okay? And he made this map. And you think, sounds like a crazy job. Why would you do something like that? But I said there was 959 cells. But the interesting thing is he found there were actually 1,061 cells. 1,061. OK, so there's an extra 102 cells. Well, John Sulston and his colleagues thought, you know, what happened to it? They disappear. And as a scientist, he wanted to ask questions. Where did they go? How did they disappear? Okay? So he looked a little bit more carefully. He used one of the things that is very powerful in C. elegans. we can make mutants. These mutants, some of them have more cells, some of them have less cells. And he used these mutants, used classical genetic techniques of mapping that you may have learned in your classes, Gregor Mendel, used these techniques, and over time he was actually able to reveal the genes. And what he found was, he discovered the genes and proteins that were important for something called programmed cell death. And you may know that as apoptosis, okay? And what this is basically a genetic process to kill cells. And you think, well, that's important, I guess. It's very important. It's very important. Because if this goes wrong, programmed cell death goes wrong, and you don't have cell death, then you have more cells, and more cells, and more cells. And what will happen? You will have a tumor, right? And you will get cancer. And that's what they found. These genes are very important for controlling cancers, as well as other diseases. And for that, John Salstead, as well as Bob Horvitz and his advisor, Cindy Brenner, got the Nobel Prize in 2002. Not only them, but Andy Fire and Craig Mello studied this similar process of development, found something called RNA interference. They won the Nobel Prize in 2006. These two scientists over here, they studied developmental processes over their careers and discovered something called microRNAs. You might have learned about these in your classes. And this is something that's very recent and very big. We have microRNAs as well, and we have hundreds of different microRNAs, and this is going to be very important later on for possibly disease therapy and many other things. They'll probably at some point also win the Nobel Prize for that too. So what I just wanted to present to you is an idea of studying C. elegans is worth it. It's a good system to study. And I hope I've convinced you of that, because I have a tremendous love for the worm. And when I started my lab, just a couple of years back, I decided I want to work with the worm too. I've been working with the worm for quite a long time. And this was exciting for me. Here's just a quick picture of our lab a few months ago. We're the Laboratory of Behavioral Genetics. And when I started my lab, I had to do something that many of you will have to do, is you have to ask a scientific question. Now, how do you ask that question, okay? How do you ask that question? So, I didn't know, when I came here about 2 years ago to Yonsei University in Wonju, I opened the door to my lab, and I said, wow, this is my lab, this is so exciting. And I went in, and it was empty. And I said, uh-oh, how am I gonna do science with an empty lab? I need money, right? I need money. I need some money. So I know what I'll do is I'll ask a scientific question that has a lot to do with money, that will give me lots of money, because I need lots of money. So my conclusion was I'll make a question that will get me lots of money. And then my first thought was, drug treatment and disease, right? And so if I can cure diseases, then they'll give me lots of money, right? And if I can find a new drug that's really good, they'll give me lots of money, right? So I thought, yeah, this is a good idea. So I actually wrote, this is actually my grant proposal. You can see it in Korean here. My first one, and I thought this was a good idea. I did something to do with drugs or something like that. I wasn't that interested, but I thought, it'll give me money. And what happened? I got rejected, which was not good. So I had to rethink this for a second. What do I need to do? And I came back and I thought, you know, why did I do science in the first place? And why do you do science in the first place? I love science. I love biology. I particularly love biology. And it's a simple thing. I should ask a question that I'm interested and passionate about. And as you enter your scientific careers too, that's one thing I just want to tell you. You need to be each one of us has our passion, our interest, or something that we love a lot. It's all different. No one is the same, really. But you just have to find that question and pursue that. And so, okay, I went back to the drawing board and I thought about scientific questions that I'm interested in. So, this is a bug, okay? And I just take pictures from my Google images, take random pictures of things. But I like this because this demonstrates what I want to talk about. If this rug is biology, there are important questions, questions of biology that lots of researchers around the world are studying. Okay? For example, some of those things are like cell signaling, very important. The development of an organism, really, really important questions. Cancer, my gosh, there are so many people studying cancer because it's important, right? It affects a lot of our lives, probably many of you, okay? Viruses, a little bit further out there, but recently we had a big virus scare here, right, in Korea. So now we know the importance of studying. These are things that are kind of the core things that people study in biology. And I like these things too, but I don't know, I'm kind of strange. I like weird things. And I like to study what I call the fringes of biology. If this is a rug, we call the outer part, these little things that hang out on the side like that, that's actually like a fringe, okay? That's a fringe. And I wanted to study things way out. A couple of things that I was really interested in. I was really interested in nature, and I was really interested in natural processes. And the first thing I'm going to talk about today is behavioral genetic ecology. There's no field. The field doesn't exist, okay? And so it's kind of in the fringes. I'm trying to make it in some ways. And the second thing I'm going to talk about today is way over here, our space. Because, I don't know, I just think it's really cool. So, C. elegans has lived in the laboratory for 50 years, starting when Sidney Meier started to work with C. elegans. 50 years ago, he brought it in the lab. Okay, this is just some random person, once again, Google images. But what I want to focus on here is the plate. This is C. elegans plate. It's a small plate. We'll look a little bit closer at that. This is one plate you can see here. What it is it's agar. And in the middle we have this like kind of whitish thing. This whitish thing here is bacteria. Okay, we put E. coli bacteria on here. And in the laboratory, we put a few worms on this. A couple days later, like I said, they reproduce very quickly. They have lots of babies. You see these little lines here, dots here, that's like C. elegans, the next generation. And those hundreds of C. elegans will also have babies, and then they'll eat all the food up, and then they'll all starve, and then all the babies will just gather like this. Okay. The thing is, E. coli, does anyone know where you find E. coli? Where do you normally find E. coli? It's in our gut, right? It's a gut bacteria. It's in our gut. So does C. elegans in nature normally find E. coli? No, not really. This is not a normal environment. Does C. elegans find agar? Probably not. This is not C. elegans environment. It's what we do in the lab. But in the environment, C. elegans does have large root sizes, it means a lot of babies, has a fast sexual maturity, and has something called an early stage dower, which I'll just say is that when the conditions are not good, they run out of food, C. elegans has this amazing hibernation stage. They say, oh, no food, and they go into hibernation, and they just stay like this, and they gather. These are things that C. elegans needs to survive in its real environment, not the laboratory. And I wanted to ask questions about the real environment. So then, where can you find C. elegans? Where can you find C. elegans? This was actually an interesting question. For many years, we studied C. elegans, but we didn't really know where to look. One day, in 2007, we had a big meeting, scientific meeting, and this guy came up and said, there will be a cash prize and species naming rights awarded to the first person to isolate a sister species to C. elegans. The cash prize of this writing is $4,000. Okay, and then meets him. All these grad students, $4,000, that's pretty good. I'll go find C. elegans. So, you know, so we went out and a lot of people started looking around. We thought it's a soil bacteria, so we'll just go to the soil, dig some up. Do I find C. elegans? No. And then we wondered, where do you find C. elegans?
Actually, after searching for a couple of years, one of the groups
found that C. elegans is actually found mostly, you can find lots of it, you can find it in many places, but you can find a lot of it concentrated in rotten fruit and vegetative compost. And probably even because it's a rich source of bacteria. C. elegans, like I said, eats bacteria. We feed it E. coli, it's looking for a lot of bacteria. And so I thought, okay, well that sounds good. By the way, in the contest, someone wanted this last month at the meeting, the Japanese group, the sister species, they got $5,000, I guess, inflation. They got $5,000. But I wanted to look for C. elegans here in Korea and study. My question is this. I want to know where it is, why is it there, how does it get there? These are the questions I wanted to understand about C. elegans. So, I just went to farms with students. And so we got pears, these are rotten pears, peaches, lots of places near Wonju. We went all the way down here, we got some apples in Chunju. We went all the way down here to Ohum to get a fruit, yuzu fruit in Korean, it's called yuja. And we just got rotten samples and we looked for C. elegans. We looked for both C. elegans and bacteria. I wanted to know what C. elegans experiences, what it needs. So what we found was no C. elegans. We didn't find C. elegans. I mean, in fact, I talked to other people, they can't find C. elegans. But we found a lot of species of nematodes that were similar. Okay? C. brizzi, C. romania, in some of these samples. Interestingly, when we looked at the bacteria in these same samples, and also in some of them in their guts, C. elegans gut, we found lactobacillus bacteria in every sample that we looked at. So my question is then, what is lactobacillus? Well, it's a lactic acid bacteria. That is also known as probiotic bacteria for the Koreans. Yusangju, right? You know that. And you guys are very familiar with probiotics because you eat your yogurts, you eat your kimchi, a lot of these crazy things that have probiotic bacteria. You have these little packets that you eat like this too with probiotic bacteria in it. So you're familiar with probiotic bacteria. But the interesting thing is, even with all its benefits, little is really known about LAB in nature, lactic acid bacteria in nature. Fortunately for me, just two doors down from us, is a laboratory, a microbiology laboratory, that studies lactic acid bacteria. And we collaborate and work together. And this is important. As a scientist, you need to talk to people, okay? You need to talk a lot. This is really, really important. Because in my conversation with him, he just told me, he's a biochemical microbiologist, he tells me this little fact. The lactic acid bacteria, when grown on citric acid switches its fermentation and in the end produces a compound called diacetyl. Diacetyl is an odor and it's responsible for a lot of the buttery tastes that we get in our cheese, yogurts, wine, and people use it a lot in foods. So if you go to the movie theaters, right, and you get that buttery popcorn smell, right? Like, oh, popcorn, right? That's diacetyl. They put diacetyl in that buttery popcorn. And what's interesting about it, it's strongly attractive to C. elegans. Strongly attractive to worms. So what does that mean? Well, I'll just quickly show you what that means. So this is a little movie that I'll show you. These are the C. elegans right here. It's a
going to see how the worms behave.
They're strongly attracted to that odor, and they move towards that odor very quickly. Okay? So that's odor attraction behavior. And C. elegans does the same thing to diacetyl. Now this was interesting, and why I found this interesting is this. Where do you find citric acid in nature? Where can we find citric acid in nature? In citrus fruits, right? In citrus fruits. So, C. elegans likes fruits, doesn't it? We find it in fruits. What we thought then was that citrus fruits, LAB will ferment that citrus fruit and over time produce diacetyl, and C. elegans is attracted to that diacetyl, and they're actually able to find the rotten fruit and all that associated bacteria in that rotten fruit. And this is our hypothesis, our working hypothesis, about what might be happening. I didn't know if this was true, but I wondered. I thought this would be interesting. Because C. elegans could smell many odors, but we didn't really know why they smelled odors. So I wanted to test this hypothesis. So with a graduate student in our lab, James Schwab, we started to do these experiments. We made media with bacteria, media without bacteria, with bacteria, different kinds of media, with citrus, with citrate, without citrate. And then we took a little piece and we tested to see if it makes diacetyl. We used a colorimetric analysis. So, and in our labs, we used the bacteria that we used was Lactobacillus paradoxa, which is a commonly found bacteria, LAB bacteria. And these were our first results. So this is diacetyl production. When we grow the LAB on an MRS-rich media, the LAB grows really well. It grows very, very well. But it doesn't produce much diacetyl. And it also doesn't produce much diacetyl on a minimal media. It doesn't grow well on a minimal media. Or a minimal glucose or a minimal citrate. But when we put both glucose and citrate in that media, it produces a lot of diacetyl. Significant amount of diacetyl. So we know that now LAB can produce diacetyl when on citrate. The question is, can C. elegans smell that diacetyl? So we took these little plugs and we did one of those assays, kind of a behavior like you saw before, and we measured its attraction behavior. And so what we have here is the attraction index. Zero means it's not very attractive, it's not really caring. And number one means it's very attractive. When we put diacetyl alone, just diacetyl chemical on there, C. elegans loves diacetyl. It's attracted to it. It's also attracted to E. coli that it eats on its plate. It likes that. But it doesn't really like LAB bacteria. If LAB is grown on a rich medium, it has no care for it. It's not really attractive. But it's when we grow LAB on citrate media, all of a sudden it's attracted to it. It's attracted to it. So we wanted to know then, well, is it attracted to it because of the diacetyl? We weren't sure, so we wanted to test that. In comes the power of C. elegans genetics. One tremendously fortunate thing about this whole project was the fact that we had something special here. How do we smell odors? How do you and I smell odors? If you don't know, we smell odors because we have odor receptors in our nose, okay? And we have hundreds and hundreds of different types of odor receptors that helps us smell very specific odors. We can smell very specific odors. C. elegans also has hundreds, if not maybe over 1,000 odor receptors in their genome. Of those 1,000, it just happens to be that we know the odor and the receptor match of diacetyl. We know the receptor for diacetyl, and that just happens to be something called odor 10.
And not only did we know the diacetyl receptor, we had a mutant that doesn't have a diacetyl receptor. Okay? So we tested this. We tested C. elegans that don't have receptors, and we saw what happens. Well, if you don't have a diacetyl receptor, you can't smell diacetyl. And you also can't smell LED on citrate. So we now know that attraction to LED on citrate requires the odor 10 diacetyl receptor. But our question was more about fruit, right? We were talking about fruit before. So we decided to make a fruit-based media. We grew the LED on that media, and we tested C. elegans attraction to that. This is just a picture of what those media look like. This is a tomato, that's an apple. Okay, and then we looked at diacetyl production on those fruit media. We used barley, tomato, apple, and used eugen. Okay? And barley and apple produce very little citrate, very little citrate. And you can see they also produce very little diacetyl, the LED growing on them. When LED is grown on tomato, tomato produces a little bit of citrate, just a little bit of diacetyl, but not. But yuzu is a citrus fruit. It produces enormous amounts of citrate. And when LED grows on it, it produces a large amount of diacetyl too. So we wanted to know if C. elegans can smell it. But C. elegans likes many things. It likes the yuzu. Here's the attraction to yuzu. It likes LED grown on yuzu. But it also likes LED grown on barley. It likes it on tomato. It likes it on apple. It likes it on many things. But our question was about diacetyl, right? So when we tested the odor 10 mutants that do not have a receptor, the yuzu attraction went down significantly, whereas the others didn't really drop too much. So it seems that the attraction to yuzu, to LED grown on yuzu, is mediated by the odor 10 receptor. Okay, so far it's been very laboratory-ish. I said ecology, I said nature. So we decided to go back to nature. What we did is we took the LED that we found in the yuzu, and this is a wild LED, and we wanted to know if it produced diacetyl, and I'll show it produces diacetyl when grown on citrate or yuzu. And then we also looked at if C. elegans is attracted to wild LED grown on citrate or yuzu. And you can see it is attracted to wild LED. Wild LED, we're not citrate and yuzu. And you can see here, it's mediated by the odor 10 receptor. Okay, so C. elegans is attracted to wild LED, we're not yuzu. But that's C. elegans from the laboratory. We wanted to test now a wild nematode. So we took C. ramonii that we found in the yuzu, and we tested, is it attracted to the wild LED? Is it attracted to the diacetyl produced by wild LED grown on yuzu? And the answer is yes. In fact, it looks just like C. elegans. This is the C. ramonii, and just like C. elegans, it's attracted to diacetyl. It's not attracted to LED on the rich media, but it is attracted to LED grown on citrate and yuzu. And so here's our summary conclusions, but basically, we sort of described the story here using C. elegans in nature. And our thought here is that nematodes need to find sources of bacteria, and they can find that in rotting fruits. And they can find those rotting fruit sources by smelling the products and the chemicals that are emitted by the bacteria. And I like this, I just really enjoy this story because it's a really nice way of describing how C. elegans uses its behavior for its benefit in ecology. Okay. So I'm going to talk about one final little story. This is now outer space. So although this is just for your entertainment, because
treasure. It's been time. down to me for a while now. Your daughter's generation will be the last to survive on Earth. You're the best pilot we ever had. Get out there and save the world.
Everybody ready to say goodbye to our solar system?
To our galaxy?
Here we go. Fast, don't worry.
Actually, we want to get there in one piece.
Hang on.
You have a mission. Our mission does not work if the people on Earth are dead by the time you pull it off.
Well, we got this far, rather than any human in history.
Well, not far, no.
Make it count.
You might have to decide between seeing your children again for the future of the human race.
We'll find a way. We always have.
So, outer space is really on the mind of our people right now. Society, interstellar, gravity, but the things of science fiction of the past always come to reality. We made it to the moon, and these days there's a big push and effort to increase space travel and habitation. Several groups, like Mars One, feel that we can make it to Mars. In fact, they think in 2026, which is a little bit fast. Other groups are saying 2030 or 2035 that we'll actually be traveling to the moon and possibly, as you see here, making settlements. Much like what we were seeing in Interstellar, except no wormholes or black holes or anything like that. But there's something you have to consider. Quite a lot of biology, not just the engineering, but also the human body. Because there are a lot of major effects of microgravity, of low gravity, cognitive balance problems, but particularly muscle and bone problems. So travel to Mars from Earth is going to take about 7 months. It's currently 5 to 7 months. That's about the same amount of time that astronauts spend on the International Space Station. When they come back, about 6 months or so to come back. And in that time, you would experience a 30% loss of muscle mass, which is enormous. Okay? So when you travel all the way here, yeah, look it out, and you open up the hatch, and then you would be similar to this astronaut here. He's not being carried because of a parade, he's being carried because he just got out of he just came to Earth. And he's lost a lot of muscle, and he has to adapt back to gravity here on Earth to be carried like this. So this is actually a major issue, and a lot of scientists have studied this. They've really focused on gravity's effect on the muscle, but actually little is known about gravity's effect on the motor neurons that innervate and connect to these muscles. Nothing is really known about this. And there's a lot of thought and reason, evidence, that neuronal development might be affected by gravity. I won't go through all of this, but basically it says muscles can affect neuronal development, and neural development can also affect muscles as well. C. elegans actually has been in space as well. So you may or may not know this story, but about 12 years ago, the space shuttle Columbia was coming into Earth, and it broke up and exploded. And unfortunately, all the astronauts died, and the space shuttle was completely blown to bits. But after that, they amazingly found the canister. And they opened up the canister. What did they find? The C. elegans plates. C. elegans actually survived the Columbia disaster, amazingly. So they've been doing C. elegans experiments in space for quite a long time because it's such a good and easy system to use. And they're continually doing more experiments. When we look at the motor neurons of C. elegans, this is C. elegans, it's a pretty nice, simple system. What you have, your motor neurons that are born here on the body side, here's the cell bodies. And over time, these motor neurons will develop. They'll cross to the other side, the dorsal side on this side, and they'll make these commissures, and they will innervate the muscle here on the dorsal side. Okay? And that's how these motor neurons develop. And we thought this would be interesting, because you can actually get pathfinding gonorrhoea, axon outgrowth and pathfinding gonorrhoea. This is what it normally looks like, but if you have some problems, these commissures, these things will go all over the place. And we wondered whether the effect of gravity could change the guidance of these neurons. How do we study microgravity? So microgravity is hard to study. We need to be either on the International Space Station or space flight. And on Earth, you can do things like a parabolic flight. You do a drop tower, but these only give you microgravity for very short amounts of time, so maybe seconds to even less than seconds. You can kind of mimic the effects of gravity in a small scale in an instrument called a clinostat, where you can just spin in different directions and different liquid, and you can actually mimic the effects of gravity. Whereas hypergravity, increased gravity, of course, can be done very easily in the laboratory, just on a centrifuge, right? Just spin, and you can just increase the gravity. So we started our experiments that way. What we did was we made a little hypergravity chamber, bring the C. elegans up, and spun them at 100 g, so it's pretty powerful, 100 g for a few days, and then we just looked at the neurons under the microscope. And what did we see? Here's our 1G situation. These are normal normal nerves here, normal neurons. They've got normal commissures that cross to the other side. When we looked at some of the worms at 100G, quite a few of them had abnormal commissures like this. Ones that go left, ones that go right. They don't reach to the other side. They stray and go all over the place. Okay? And we thought that was very interesting, that gravity just force itself to change the direction of this. And we wanted to know, you can actually quantify this. This is at 36 hours, 60 hours and 72 hours. Here in the green, you have 100 G, so you have an increased amount of axonal defects. And if we just calculate the difference between here and here and here, we see here. We see about a 30 to 40% increase in defects induced by hypergravity. So our goal right now is to figure out why that is occurring. We don't necessarily know exactly why that's occurring, but our first thought is that hypergravity might just be damaging, breaking, cutting, or something. But the interesting thing about damaging them, breaking them, cutting, if you cut the axons, okay, they will regrow. They will regenerate, they will repair over time. So if we induce the effects and then give them some time to repair, then we can find out whether it's just a damage. So that's what we did. For 36 hours, this is the amount of defects that we see. Okay? And then if you do it for 72 hours, it's the amount of defects we see. But instead, we do 36 hours and then give it 36 hours in 1G, some time to regenerate or repair. Maybe those axons will repair. But as you can see, it doesn't really look right. In fact, it looks almost the same 36 and 72 hours. So our thought here is that it may not be damage. It may not be axonal damage. And Saraswati, the PhD student that's working on this, has quite a lot of data other than this data. Some genetic data to show that it doesn't look like it's axonal damage. It's probably something else. Sort of skip this. This project is actually ongoing right now. It's happening just currently right now. Our question, like I said, is we want to know what gravity is doing. Right? What's hypergravity's effect on the development? Our thought right now is actually it's an axon of guidance. It's an axon of guidance. And somehow, these axons, when they grow out, they follow a cue, and they move around, but then they can't find it. We actually looked at some other neurons, too. These were sensory neurons development. Sensory neuron development was not affected at all. They were very normal. So we think this is specific to these motor neurons. So we're doing some more experiments about that. One interesting thing is, currently I just got an email today. We got awarded a climate staff from the United Nations, so they're actually mailing it to us this week. So we're gonna try to do some microgravity experiments as well to see if microgravity, less gravity, can actually mean some effects on neuron development. So just a little plug of some things. So we have about 15 professors in our biological science and technology division. And five of us are actually working on some aspects of space biology. As you can see here, we also have at Yonsei University STARS, which is the Science and Technology Alliance for Research in Space. So we're kind of trying to develop a sort of a space biology kind of group here in Korea. And so if you're at all interested, let me know. Just want to acknowledge people that did this work. This is Sarah Swati. She's a PhD student. She did most of the experiments on hypergravity. Dongyang also here helped out with a lot of those experiments. An older picture, yes. A big picture. I need a sample. Tame was a master's student. She did the experiments with the yuzu and the bacteria, and she just graduated recently. So that's it. Thank you. If you have any questions.